Good afternoon. I am very short, so most of you cannot see. So it's better to light on this. At the very outset, I would like to thank India Foundation for the Arts, Arundhati Kaur, Suman Gopinath, and all her teams. This is one of the privileges that we are getting today, and only because of this, I have been here. This kind of museum and archival conference has been hosting for the first time, so far I know, and like National Museum, Indian Museum, leading museums in our country has never thought of museum and archival fellowship. So I just want to congratulate, and only for this reason I have come here to share my pleasure and concern about our heritage. Every one of you who have been in leading museums, especially in Western countries, you might have seen that Shiva in dancing, we call it Nataraja also, either in bronze, normally in bronze, but we have Shiva in dancing in a stone also. Wherever we visit leading museums, this image has been adorned in all the leading museums. Our bureaucrats, our politicians, all the enlightened troops, they know how powerful, how strong and powerful our Indian art, culture, and history is. But unfortunately, when they come back to our own country, like National Museum, Indian Museum, excepting Shivaji Museum in Mumbai, Sarojini Museum, excluding these two museums, starting from National Museum to State Museums, condition, policy, program, all these are still in a nascent stage. So, along with this introduction, let me come to my perspective, which I'm going to share. Is a little bit, it may, candidly I'm going to express my viewpoint, which may hurt some of the feelings, some of the observation, but bear with me, because this is my 26 years of museum professional experience, and I'm sharing honestly through my 26 years service experience, where you know that Assam is the most largest state in Northeast India, northeastern part of India, and it has a very good collection. Museum was opened in the year 1940. Now it is going to complete 79 years of museum functioning. We have 15,000 objects with 13 galleries. Some of the objects which I'm going to highlight will reflect how rich we have, but unfortunately I don't have much slides, but I will just give some context about our museum. In spite of 79 years, museum has been facing a lot of problems and issues that will come subsequently. During the last 6 years of my directorship, we have initiated a lot of innovative schemes, and we are planning to acquire some objects from neighboring states neighboring countries and Southeast Asian nations. And two objects have been selected from Cambodia. So we have a far-sighted vision and strategy. So at the outset, our vision is ambitious, but there are some paradox that will subsequently come later on. So that is one of the issues that I want to narrate today. Coming back to our museum, we have these four, I just want to show you four objects. Yes, these four medallions have been found in Kahilepara, within the heart of the Guwahati city. And you know, Assam has a very flux, continuous flux of races from Siliguri to mainland India is the mostly populated and inhabited by Indo-Aryans. And you know, Leto in the Tinsukia extreme east, from that point to the eastern side, Myanmar, Vietnam, Korea, Indonesia, these are the Mongoloid inhabited region. And in between Leto to Siliguri, further Brahmaputra belt has been inhabited by Mongoloid and Indo-Aryans. And these two racial groups has been assimilating, living together, and convergence in terms of race, in terms of culture, tradition took place. So here, this is the image of Mahesa Martini. Mahesa Martini in our North India, South India, in living temple images, it has been depicted in many different forms. Mahesa Martini is one of the most important images, the slayer of buffalo demon. And Mahesa Martini belongs to images of one of the divinity of Shakti girl. And Mahesa Martini has virtues of compassion, power, and many aspects, and has been especially in West Bengal. Durkama is another representation of Mahesa Martini. Here, I would like to bring from the context of some other context, not from Hindu iconography. Most of you belonging to art history, and you know much better than me regarding this iconography from Hindu perspective. Now, I want to bring this from the perspective of context, contextuals. Every artwork also exists in time and space and has context. This needs to correlate with the social cultural life of 6th to 12th century AD Assam. As I have mentioned, entire Brahmaputra has been populated by ethnic groups, Mongoloid race, as well as Indo-Aryan. The later groups entered in Brahmaputra Valley sometimes in 6th century AD. On the above premise, let us see this image again from the physiognomic perspective. We find in this image easily distinct anatomical feature of Aryan as well as Mongoloid race. The slanting eye in a Hindu iconography, full fist shape. When we look from anthropological physiognomic perspective, this is a slanting eye. But Hindu iconography perspective, they say this is a full fist shape. So let us look from anthropological perspective. Round face with prominent cheek. This is also features of the Mongoloid race. While very sharp spine, pointed and sharp nose are the distinct feature of Indo-Aryan. So this image is truly manifestation of convergence of this races, tradition, culture in the form of art. It is here in the Brahmaputra Valley, east and west are completely converged and assimilated unlike any part in the world. This phenomenon has shattered maxim opined by the great writers, thinker, Rudyard Kipling. Kipling opined that east, west is west, the twain never meet. Thus, this timeless Sati image exhibit a syncretic icon perfectly representing fusion of the Hindu elements. This gives us collective memory and also meaning when we look from social, cultural, and context of the time. It gives us more meaning. It also reminds harmonious and ethos and harmonies of the people who live in the Brahmaputra Valley. So these aspects is to be represented, and we need to focus in time when societies are polarizing. Heritage has the power. Heritage can mend. So this is on the area State Museum Assam is looking forward. As I have pointed out, what ails with the two most important national museums of our country? I agree with the first, some of my predecessors, many activities, exhibitions, they have initiated, but in terms of policy, in terms of collaborative, in terms of leadership pipeline, many areas they have not focused. It is, in my view, it is not the fault of the people in those positions. Perhaps it is the way we all have framed the role. That may be the reason. I'm involved as a director. I'm involved in. So it is time to wake up and we look to drastic changes and use our great resources as a center of enjoyment and learning of timeless treasures of our civilization. Some main crux problem is probably we lack interest and awareness. The authority in the higher level does not engage and inspire employees. Definitely, there is lack of a singular legislative framework for the museum and inefficient process. These are some of the reasons that our museums are not changing. Yes, I just want to remind that Bihar has come up with a huge project, and that is very challenging. It's an eye-opener, and they have a beautiful object, Yakshi. And like Mona Lisa in the Louvre, Yakshi is one of the timeless treasures of our country, and Bihar has taken initiative. But how far in terms of human resources they have taken steps that needs to be thought out. Now, due to time constraint, I just want to share one more thought that I have been doing now. The theme Old Roads, New Journey is really relevant for and meaningful dialogue today. As director managing 11 museums under the Directorate of Museums Assam, as one of the speakers has pointed out, curators are the cutting edge employees for any museum. But unfortunately, many of the museums are not having curators, conservators, and that is one of the greatest challenges that I'm facing. My vision is very huge, but I have no curator. I have no conservator right now. Fortunately, Rongali Biswas and Jubini Lotha, I facilitate exhibition in Assam State Museum. But as a director, I did my best. But unfortunately, when events are to be hosted, some lacuna develop, subordinates, things could not move. So sometimes I may be too ambitious without knowing my own reality. So that is one issue. But with a small budget, we can do more. So I have learned a lesson that less is more, small is beautiful. So museum, every museum should make proper plan systematically. And I used to invite smaller groups, closer interaction, and meaningfully time is spent. So these are some of the strategies that smaller museums should adopt. So with this word, let me conclude, and my colleague Sonal Jain will enlighten about our activities. And in the month of April, we are going to have an exhibition on IFA and Assam State Museum collaborative event. Any one of you visiting Assam in the month of April, you are welcome, and I would warmly receive every one of you who visit Assam during that time. Thank you.
Thank you everybody for being here. Thank you IFA and the Goethe and Mr. Wunglengton and the Assam State Museum for hosting the project that my partner Mrigank and I are doing there as Design Machine Collective. I want to first, also mention that Mr. Wunglengton is, a power in the Assam State Museum. And in his tenure, there have been so many events. It's been, the museum itself has been enlivened in so many different ways that, I don't remember at all before his tenure started. Amar Kanwar has actually done, has had his entire big installation there, and which went on for months. So, he's doing a commendable job, and I thank him for, having the energy that he does. And now coming to the intervention that we have done there, I want to start by saying that as Design Machine Collective, it's always been our endeavor to look at spaces and look at spaces which are also redundant or abandoned and other things. So, in some ways, this is also an extension of our periphery project, because the periphery project is something we started on a ferry. And, the endeavor was to, instead of creating institutions and, building buildings and spaces, look at existing spaces and activating them and trying to do something. So, the first thing is, reviewing of spaces and place. I remember as a child and growing up, in the district museums or the state museums in the Northeast, which would be for me Shillong, Assam, and Arunachal Pradesh, there was always a strange sense of melancholy that came over. That was the, you know, feeling that I always left with. So there were spaces, as a child, these were spaces that housed objects, objects from the past and of a particular culture and people. This was based on the presumption of both difference and extinction in these collections. The spaces were mostly dark, without windows, and mostly isolated and carried a desolate and musty air. These cathedrals of modernity, I have come to realize, are ruins and places of abandonment. And that is what draws me towards them. By displaying their active and ongoing process of ruining, these modern ruins afford an observation of and engagement with things in their various state of abandonment and decay. The objects and things within the collection too exhibit an otherness, qualities that become manifest when they lose their relation of usefulness and maintenance. They occupy a position of waste and heritage, with only those objects having an age value which fit into the current political economy of the past and thus have some cultural value. These museums fall well within the purview of the colonial project of controlling the present, future, and rewriting the past. To quote Fanon, colonialism is not satisfied merely with holding a people in its grip and emptying the native's brain of all forms of content. By a kind of perverted logic, it turns to the past of the people and distorts, disfigures, and destroys it. This work of devaluing pre-colonial history takes on a dialectical significance today. Also, to paraphrase Howard Adams, the native people in a colony are not allowed to a valid interpretation of their history because the conquered do not write their own history. This, of course, completely, you know, fits well with the region that I'm coming from, Assam and Northeast, which for us can be viewed as the south of the global south. And to, you know, come back to what Muzammil had said, you know, my earliest memories of, I studied in Baroda Fine Arts, and you know, whenever I said I was from Shillong, a lot of times I was also said, oh, Ceylon. And I was like, you know, where are these people coming from? And I still got it last year. So, you know, not much has changed in that sense. And the Northeast and Assam, Meghalaya have been, you know, they've always got these various tags of underdeveloped, isolated frontier, ethnically different, physically distant, disturbed area, fraught with insurgency, the exotic, and thus always the other. This again was a very, very different before control and national borders came about. And you know, like other frontier areas, Northeast always had dynamic links with Tibet, Myanmar, Bhutan, and its other neighbors, which to quite an extent still exists, because some of the experiences of being in these border areas is that people are still coming over without any, you know, regulation and all of that. So the next attempt was, of course, to recreate new narratives, and situating cultural value to the site of the museum itself and its objects and things we first look at the very nature of culture itself. Starting with a quote from Trinity Minha, "This is not to say that the historical eye can be obscured or ignored, and that differentiation cannot be made. But that eye is not unitary. Culture has never been monolithic." So of course, culture is something that is, you know, continuing, it's moving. And the only, you know, way that we actually look at culture is a hybrid construct. Subjectivity is constructed and authenticity contingent. The objects in the museum may elicit different interpretations. However, I would like to tie the gaze on the object also from what we have been experiencing as a growing concern for things and the material aspect of culture. It is even claimed that we are facing a paradigm shift, a radical turn away from the linguistic hegemony of postmodernism towards what is variously being called new materialism, new realism, and post-humanism. While they are diverse, a shared concern for these isms is clearly to assign matter, things, or the real a new stance of significance. So this is also an approach that we are taking while approaching the exhibits of the museum. Hence, much effort has been put into abandoning modern negative dualities between mind and matter, inert, meaningless things, and creative, thoughtful humans, and to adopt a more inclusive and flat ontology. Through the power of relations and entanglements, things and other non-humans are seen as holders of agency comparable to their human actors. So the next section is the, you know, something that I think some of the other speakers touched upon is to remember. Here we touch upon the materiality of memory and the affective aspects of material encounters in the museum. Museums enchant, objects enchant us and hold us captive. And my favorite, you know, example for this is Orhan Pamuk's The Museum of Innocence, where the author is at once able to captivate me, not only with the narrative, but with the objects in the story having their own narratives, and with the subsequent museumization of the objects itself. The nature of memory itself is fragmented and incomplete. So is any museum collection, being at the same time open to the potentials, meanings, and ineffable memories afforded by this very fragmented otherness. Oral cultures is something that I'd like to, you know, touch upon because that's such an important part of the culture that, you know, the Northeast inhabits. So oral cultures memorize thousands of songs, stories, chants, poems. The Aboriginal people demonstrate that their oral traditions are not only highly detailed and complex, but they can survive accurately for thousands and even 10,000 of years. Today, practically the whole of human knowledge is available to us on a tap of a button. However, memory in the age of information, caught in this constant stream of data, seems to form more a rhizomatic structure that is disoriented, non-narrative, and anti-narrative in its fundamental organization. Carolyn Cooper argues, oratrocy is not merely the absence of literacy, it is a way of seeing, a knowledge system. The Khasi compute their history with the Mao or stone, and the Khasi word for memory is Kinmao, or rooted in stone. So what we have been trying to do with the museum collection is also to reuse the spaces and the objects in different ways, so to give them different interpretations. And one of the first events that we organized was with a young NSD graduate who is from Meghalaya. She's from Shillong. Her name is Labdiang CM. And so she comes from the background of theater, but she also does physical theater. And she reenacted the story of Nokalikai, which is basically a waterfall, but the myth behind it is that the woman who, there was a woman who basically was, who had a child and her husband was there. And when she remarried, her new husband hated the child. And because of, one day when she comes home, she, is greeted with a beautiful meal of meat and she savors it, completely. She really enjoys it, and after that she finds a finger in a basket. She realizes that her husband had actually killed her child and fed her the child, and she is completely distraught, and she jumps off a cliff, which subsequently becomes a waterfall. So this is the performance that Labdiang CM had enacted, and these are just a few stills from that. But also what's interesting is that the Khasi culture is matrilineal, and a lot of times the perception is that women are much more empowered, and they definitely are, but there is the other side to it as well, because it's not a matriarchal culture but a matrilineal. So, they're not really part of the electoral process as much, or the decision making. So it is a very interesting take on that, but also What Labdiang did was, you know, performed this in the Mask Museum, in the Mask Gallery, and her whole interest was again to see how, you know, these dead objects become alive because of the performance there and how they interact with the performance itself. This is Rhys Thimble. He is a Welsh poet, and he joined in with Labdiang's performance. And his position is also very interesting as a poet because he does performative bits. And his entire take was also looking at, you know, Wales as the first colony of the British. So in that sense, again, you know, it was a very interesting performance. They, you know, also collaborated on this. And the piece that he made was called Cursed Blessed because, you know, Labdiang's piece was about this girl who was cursed. And he kind of, you know, deconstructs it, and he uses a lot of Welsh language as well, which was really very interesting and powerful to hear. So I'll stop here. Thank you.